So thanks. Like I already said, I'm going to talk about what I had to do to integrate SELinux into CRIU. The goal was to enable container migration with SELinux enabled after and before the migration, and to have the same context after and before the migration. I am at Red Hat's kernel team. I'm doing process migration, what CRIU does. For at least for, I don't know, 10 years probably, I'm involved in CRIU since 2012 when it came up. And basically, all I'm going to talk today about is all the fault of some CI system, which forced me to finally look to in it. Because honestly, this is all my fault, because I knew that SELinux support in CRIU was missing, but I kind of kept on ignoring it for a few years. So that's a story of a long-lasting technical debt, what I want to talk about today. So this all started in around 2011 when CRIU was first introduced at LPC in 2011. And at that time, there were multiple checkpoint restore implementations which were existing, which were implemented differently, completely in user space, completely in kernel space, using syscall interception. There were a lot of things, and CRIU kind of was the result of many different implementations at a time, and CRIU stands for checkpoint restore in user space, and it does a lot of things in user space, but it uses existing kernel interfaces as fast as possible. And to understand a bit why the problem with SELinux existed for such a long time with CRIU was, the first thing how I got involved in CRIU was I introduced a Fedora package into Fedora for CRIU in 2012. There was a process, I followed it, and in Fedora 19, there was CRIU available for all the users. And at that time, it didn't have SELinux support, but for RPM packaging to would have picked up SELinux support at that time, the packaging would have to have known about that it should install libSELinux in the build root, and then CRIU would have been built against SELinux. But this didn't exist because CRIU didn't have any SELinux support, so it just worked without SELinux, and for like 3 years, nobody really looked into any LSM support for CRIU. So in 2015, Tycho implemented for CRIU LSM support, and his work was focused on UpArmor to get it working with LexC, LexD to do container migration there with keeping AppArmor context correctly. And what he basically did is, during checkpointing, he just read the value out of current for each process CRIU dumped to disk. And during restore, the value was read back to disk. And once the process was created, for each process in thread, he just updated the current with the value from the restore. That was the AppArmor support. And SELinux support basically looked like this. So it basically said, if you're not running in an unconfined context, CRIU will just abort. So if you're running with SELinux enabled and the context is unconfined, then okay, I will not do anything. I will not read out the context. I will not restore it. So it probably will work for you. But if you're running in something else, CRIU will just ignore it and bail out, and you're on your own. It doesn't work anymore. So CRIU had now some limited SELinux support, but a CRIU package didn't, because I didn't put in the build requires in 2012. So this meant that the package in Fedora didn't support SELinux, and also when I ported it to RHEL, the RHEL CRIU package also didn't support SELinux. In 2018, I started to work on getting CRIU into Podman for container migration, and I implemented it all and submitted a pull request. And I was asked to provide a test, and I wrote a test, and it worked, because at that time, Podman was still running on Travis, and Travis doesn't have SELinux enabled, so all the SELinux things which Podman tried to do were not happening, and so CRIU was still happy, the restore was still happy. Nothing broke at that point of time. At some point, Podman moved away from Travis to a CI system with SELinux enabled, and checkpointing and restoring containers still worked because the CRIU package was built without SELinux support. And then when I continued to work on new features for CRIU and Podman, I had to build CRIU from sources because the things were not in the Fedora package yet, and so the CI system built for me the latest CRIU package. The CI system had libSELinux installed, so CRIU all of a sudden was running with SELinux support, the limited one it had. And at that point, nothing worked concerning container migration anymore. And CRIU broke in multiple ways, which I found out later. But the first thing I saw basically was this denial, and it's a strange denial because as far as I understood to read it, it says source context. The third line, it says the source context of the denial is from a process running in container T context, and it tries to talk to something target context, I guess, to container runtime T. And the process is top, so that was running in the container, and it tries to do a connect. So somehow the process in the container tries to connect to the outside of the container for some reason, which looked really strange in the beginning. And I titled this slide as Parasite Code, and the reason for this is CRIU's Parasite Code. So I just want to shortly introduce CRIU's Parasite Code. To dump the memory of a process from within the process's namespace, CRIU uses something which it calls Parasite Code. Parasite code is injected into the process using ptrace, and then it's basically a daemon running in the process to be dumped. And this daemon waits for commands, and it connects to the main CRIU process running outside of the container in our case. And the parasite code is removed after usage, and the process doesn't know it was under control. But basically, this explains the thing. So you see, the parasite code is injected into the top process, which is running in the container, and now the process in the container wants to talk to the outside of the container, which seems strange and shouldn't really be necessary. So SELinux blocked this, and this was correct, and so I had to fix it in CRIU. And this wasn't really too hard to fix it because I just had to read out the context of the process of the container and label the parasite code, which is running on the outside of the container, using setsock createcon to enable the parasite code in the container to talk to the outside of the container. After that, I'm resetting the socket context to the default, and everything is good. So this was the theory, and this is where it got really complicated, because the CRIU package didn't have correct SELinux support. So to enable the correct socket labeling, I first had to fix all of the existing or non-existing CRIU SELinux support. So my first step was to do just what AppArmor does. I'm reading out current during checkpointing. I'm writing it back during restore. The one thing which seems to be different, I need an additional policy to allow a process to change from one context to another, because usually it's not expected that processes are changing their context on their own, and that's what CRIU would do during restore. So it would start as the if you talk about a container context, it would start as the process out of the container, and during restore, the process would be relabeled to be a process inside of the container, what it actually is. And the idea, I guess, of SELinux is to use set execcon to set a context of a new process you're gonna execute, but because CRIU uses clone to recreate all the processes it wants to restore, this didn't work for me. So I had to talk to SELinux policy maintainers to get me a DIN transition policy to enable CRIU to change the context of a running process during the restore. So this meant when I enabled this here, in the Fedora package with the existing newly implemented SELinux supporting CRIU. This would break a lot of users because all of a sudden they used to expect that their package, that CRIU would just restore and checkpoint and restore any process they have. All of a sudden, if it's not running in the unconfined context, it would stop right now. So I had to coordinate the changes in the Fedora package with the DIN transition policy for the containers. So now we have a transition policy for containers, which allows containers to change from container runtime T to container T during runtime. And we added an additional Boolean in Fedora to allow processes to change their context if the user wants it on the system, but they actually have to enable it manually. But at least there is a way, if they come to the point where it fails, to enable it manually. So everything seemed to work so far. I had to wait all the changes to appear on Podman CI. And most of the problems at this point were gone with container migration and SELinux policies. But there was, again, CI error. It seems kind of unrelated because the container migration which failed was the migration of a Redis server. So this was, I only introduced this to be able to check the migration of established TCP connections. And because Redis was the one thing which was already used in the CI, I just reused it, opened the TCP connection, migrated it, and checked that the TCP connection is still there. But this thing failed, and this was the only one which actually uses threads. So this, I actually only tested it with containers which contained only processes and no threads, and this was the only one which was using threads. And the SELinux error message I got now was totally different, and it took me a while to understand because it was actually an error, and I found this line in the Linux kernel which says that it's only possible to change the context of single-threaded processes in SELinux. And I saw that this line was mostly unchanged since 2008, so it seemed pretty unlikely that I would be able to convince someone to change this line there so that I can change context of threads with SELinux. I later found out that it's possible if you are using bounded SELinux policies, so they somehow are connected together as far as I understood it, but talking to the policy maintainers in Fedora, it seemed nothing is using bounded policies there, so I stayed away from using bounded policies for the container migration. And the solution was basically for UpArmor, when we're restoring a process and we are creating threads, we are also writing restoring the context for each thread with UpArmor and CRIU. And we don't do this with SELinux, so we only set the context for each newly created process, and we then create the threads later with the label of the previously created process. This means currently we cannot migrate containers which where the threads have different labels than the processes in the container, but as far as I have seen it, at least for the Podman migration case, all processes in the container so far seem to have the same context. So this is a limitation, but which is not relevant to the use case I was looking on. So we didn't change the thread context, only the process context. This led to another problem with CRIU. So to restore a process, CRIU does something which sometimes we call the PID dance. You want to restore the process with the same PID it had during checkpointing. So there's a file in proc where you can influence the next PID of the restored process. And this file is not writable from the container from the container T context the container is running in. So we relabel the file to be writable from a container during restore. And so we were able to correctly restore processes, containers with multiple processes and with multiple threads. And it looked really good. So CI was happy. Everything seemed to work. But at that point, I found another problem. So this was actually not found by CI, but by myself. So if I migrate a process from one system to another, and it uses sockets, and I try to connect to the socket, the accept fails after the migration. And the reason is I didn't correctly relabel the sockets after migration. I only labeled the processes, but not the sockets. So this was basically solved by CRIU. So I use, I'm reading out the label of the socket during checkpointing. I'm writing it back during restore. I'm reading out also the attribute which is stored in sock create to make sure that newly created sockets in the restore process only also are created with the correct contexts if the process in the container actually has a different context for sockets. So then there was a small thing. This was not fatal in any way for the migration, but we had SELinux error messages, so the log files were not labeled correctly. So I just let Podman create a CRIU log files with the correct labels. Then there were a few additional messages where we had file descriptors leak into IP tables, which you use to block the network during migration of containers with established TCP connections. And at that point, we were actually able to migrate all the containers in CI and all the ones I'm testing with without any SELinux failures and all labels restored correctly. So the steps we had to do to the steps I just mentioned here today were we had to label the socket for the parasite daemon correctly. We had to read and write the value from a proc attribute current correctly. We had to allow din transitions to be able to migrate one for the restore to change the socket to change the context of the process. We had to relabel NSLastPit to be able to create threads correctly in CRIU. We had to fix the socket labels, pre-create all the log files, and make sure we don't leak any file descriptors out into processes which we are calling during restore. And with that, I'm already end. The first link is also a blog post which contains all the information here, and I'm already at the end. Thanks for the attention. Any questions about for you?
Questions?
So could you tell us just a little bit about what you had to do in order to get the order of execution correct? Because it would seem that when you're restoring a container, you're going to have to be very careful about getting the order that you're setting things up correct.
So one of my first tries was I'm just labeling the process as early as possible. I'm telling CRIU, I think actually one of the first things I was using set execcon to run CRIU completely under the destination context. But the problem is then CRIU does crazy things during restore, and so I had like 50 different SELinux denials during restore. And so we changed it to restore all the labels as late as possible. So we do as much as possible during the restore, and really one of the last steps is to restore the labels of the processes. We can do it earlier for the sockets, that's no problem because they are not really used once they are set up, but for the processes, because CRIU morphs the processes itself from the CRIU binary into the restored binary, and so we try to do the things as long as possible in our original context. And just basically, I think the third last thing is setting the SELinux context and seccomp or UpArmor.
More questions? Now let's thank the speaker.
Thanks.